Morning. Thank you for joining us for Coast Day. My name is Chris Hauser. I'm the Associate Director of Delaware Sea Grant. This session is Pathways in Marine Science in the Exploration Track, which is brought to you by the Bureau of Ocean Energy Management. The purpose of this session is to share the career paths of three early to mid-career professionals in the fields of coastal and marine science. Before we begin, I want to remind you that you can submit questions for the panelists during the presentation using the Q&A app at the bottom of your Zoom screen. We'll address as many of these questions as we can towards the end of the session. Our three panelists today are Samuel Fielding, Lane Johnston, and Ashley Norton. Sam is a PhD student at the University of Delaware in the Marine Policy Program and is currently a NOAA Sea Grant Knaus Fellow with the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers. Sam is a former Fulbright scholar whose work has primarily been focused on environmental economics and policy. Lane Johnston is the program's manager at the Responsible Offshore Development Alliance, where she helps bridge the conversation between marine policy, research, and ocean resources planning. Her work primarily aims to integrate fisheries concerns in offshore renewable energy planning. Lane received her master's degree from the University of Delaware. Ashley Norton is the section planner for the DENREC Shoreline and Waterway Management section. In this role, she works on long-term planning and management strategies for Delaware's beaches, creeks, rivers, dams, and floodplains, including dredging and beach nourishment projects. Ashley received her undergraduate degree in marine science at Stony Brook University on Long Island, her master's in coastal geology at the University of Delaware, and her PhD in Earth Science at the Center for Coastal and Ocean Mapping at the University of New Hampshire. All of our panelists have a strong connection to Delaware Sea Grant. Delaware Sea Grant administers the Knaus Fellowship Program. Lane was a former Delaware Sea Grant intern, and Dr. Norton is currently a principal investigator on a Delaware Sea Grant funded research project. Panelists, welcome. To start today's discussion, I want to ask each of you to describe your role and your responsibilities in your current position. Sam, we'll begin with you.
Okay, I think you can see me. Hello, everybody. So my name is Sam, and like Chris mentioned, I am a NOAA Sea Grant Knaus Marine Policy Fellow. And if you've never heard of that before, it's a one-year fellowship which is designed to provide graduate students interested in marine and coastal issues from a variety of disciplines to be engaged in the policy process. So for myself, I was matched with the Army Corps of Engineers and working with their Engineering with Nature initiative. And this is a broad program designed to better align engineering objectives with natural processes. And given that my background is mostly in social sciences and economics, my responsibilities so far have been trying to explore how to quantify and bring in the benefits of these natural-based solutions and how to work these benefits into the planning process for the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers. Thank you.
Thanks, Sam. Lane, how about you?
Good morning, everybody. I'm Lane Johnston, as Chris mentioned. I'm the programs manager for the Responsible Offshore Development Alliance. And we are our organization is a coalition of commercial fishing industry members, businesses, associations, pretty much anybody who's primarily their business is results from commercial fishing. And particularly, we work with our members to understand how their operations may be impacted by offshore wind development. And we help to convey that those concerns to federal and state agencies. We also advocate for science to address some of these unknowns with future development plans and how offshore wind development in the marine ecosystem might impact fishing and fishing interests. Thank you.
And Dr. Norton?
Hi, good morning, everyone. I'm Ashley Norton. I'm a section planner with the DENREC Shoreline and Waterway Management section. So our section does a variety of different activities on the coastline and in the waterways. For shoreline management, we sponsor research sometimes with the University of Delaware And we work with the Army Corps of Engineers on beach nourishment projects on the ocean coast, as well as some beach nourishment projects on the bay coast as well. In waterway management, we're responsible for dredging the inland bays. And some of that is the actual dredging projects themselves. And my responsibility is to do the planning of those projects. So figuring out which channels need our attention and innovative ways that we can perform those kind of projects. So one thing we do is beneficial use of sediments, right? So when we dredge the sediments, can we use that for environmental restoration or for beach nourishment projects? We also have a dam safety program. So we're responsible for managing dams across the state of Delaware. One of the exciting things that I think I get to do in my job is that long-term planning and strategic planning for the coast. So not just those individual projects, but figuring out, you know, what do we want our beaches to look like going forward? And that includes research and economics. Thank you.
Great. Next question, and we'll answer these in the same order. Could each of you tell me what the most important steps in your career have been to get to your current position? Was it your education, internship opportunities, prior work experience, or something else that helped to get you where you are?
Okay. For myself, I'm still a student and very much in the early stages of my career. That being said, I've kind of taken a very meandering route to get to where I am. My undergraduate and my master's were both very interdisciplinary, but were largely focused around environmental policy and had some economics, international relations, ecology, all kind of thrown in. I've also spent a significant time in Asia as well, where after my undergraduate, I did a Fulbright English teaching scholarship. And then again, after my master's, I went to Xiamen, China, researching coastal vulnerability, also on a Fulbright scholarship. And then I spent several years living and working in China before I decided that I wanted to go back to school, continue working in the environmental field at UD. And in general, I would say they've been mostly kind of driven by these transdisciplinary questions where society and environment interacts and where the solutions need to be bridging natural science, economics, and really making those connections. So for myself, I've sought out opportunities where people have similar interests, and that's landed me where I am now.
Thank you. Lane?
And I have to ask Sam about all those experiences. It sounds way more interesting than what I'm about to say. I think I'm pretty new in my career as well. For sure, education has been so important to giving me a foundation to be where I am. And really just that learning how to think critically through asking scientific research questions and how to address them has really served me well. Like Chris mentioned, I was intern with Stella Ray Sea Grant and Department of Natural Resources, DENREC. Oh, forgetting acronyms now, there's too many in fisheries. But that internship really was my first opportunity to work with people that are outside of my lab, outside of academia, and I really, really valued that experience. So I think the most important steps for me in my career was to, transitioning from my education into my career was just to make those connections outside of the world that you are in day in and day out. So talking to people who weren't in my lab, talking to people outside of academia, really for me, where I wanted to go was into the policy world. And that was really the best way to do that. Actually randomly made the connection to this job that I have now. Because of my internship with DENREC and Sea Grant, my future employers or now employers had talked to some of those people that I worked with during my internship time. So you never know what connections you make and how far that those reaches are and how that can help you. So I think just making connections far and wide as possible has been the most valuable to me.
Thank you. Ashley?
I'm going to echo some of what Lane said, actually. Making connections outside of academia was huge for me. So I think my PhD experience was really valuable, and it was a really applied PhD. So I worked on coastal mapping, which is, you know, very relevant to when you want to manage the coast. And so as a part of that, I got really solid technical skills that I could use in the state. And on top of that, then I took that and I did an internship with the New Hampshire Coastal Program. And so it was the same thing, sort of getting those connections outside of academia, seeing where my academic skills, like my critical thinking that I was doing for my PhD, the technical mapping skills, how that all fit into coastal management issues. And I think that really helped me when I was applying for jobs. And I think it's helping me every day in my job at Denver.
Great. The next question to discuss: what type of skills do you need to be successful in your current position? Sam?
For this current fellowship, I think the ability to read and synthesize information across a variety of backgrounds, engineering, law, and then be able to communicate your findings effectively is probably the most important skill. Apart from that, maybe time management, and that's definitely something that I'm still working on.
Great, thanks. Lane?
So I was a marine biosciences master's student at UD. So I was like in my lab doing that lab work and doing field research, and that was great. The policy world that I'm now in is very different from the science and research world and academia. So I think the skills that I learned are very valuable, but figuring out how the application of science applies to real world gives light to real world implications. So really kind of like turning that corner and like, what does the science actually mean? How does the science actually change how we view things or manage things or put in regulations is something that's kind of a hard skill to verbalize, but I think that's something that I need, that I also continue to work on, but it's been very vital to my position now. And then because of that, my writing skills have had to increase a lot. Science writing is very different than the kind of writing I do now. So I think that's a big one for me.
Dr. Norton.
I'm gonna again echo some of what Lane said. So I think the biggest skill or the most important skill in my job is being able to communicate with different audiences. So sometimes, you know, I'm talking to sort of my own tribe, right? Sometimes I'm talking to coastal scientists about very technical issues at the coast and changes at the beaches. But a lot of my job, I'm working with sometimes town officials, mayors, sometimes communicating really complex technical issues to Denrec leadership. So, you know, something that a scientist might write a 15-page paper on, I need to distill that down to a one-page sort of important summary of what the findings are or what the project is doing. So I think communication is a really important skill and communicating with different audiences. The other skill, I'll go back to my mapping skills. I think you can't manage resources at the coast without knowing where they are. And so being able to jump right in and take geographic data and look at what's going on at the beaches and where is really huge. So I would always recommend people get GIS experience, geographic information systems. I think that's a huge skill to have.
Great. The next question: what opportunities do you wish you had taken advantage of or had available to you as you've gone through your education and started your career and progressed through your career? Sam?
Good question. I think earlier on during my undergraduate, I would have benefited from more math courses. It's just been surprising to me how often that's come up as a skill that's actually used and as a prerequisite. Other than that, though, I think just reaching out, putting yourself out there is something that seems difficult to do, but is really valuable. And so whether that's asking an industry professional for career advice or signing up for a mentoring program, looking for internships, volunteering for local organizations, there's lots of opportunity out there, but you have to go out and look and put yourself out there.
Thank you. Lane?
Based on where my position is now, I work so closely with the commercial fishing industry. I wish I had more connections to regulators and policymakers in the commercial fishing industry before starting my new position. That is pretty specific to what I do now, but I think kind of what I was saying before, that really being better about what you're going to do with the science, what are you going to do with the understanding, and how it's going to be applied to the bigger world is really important. So the real world application, I guess, figuring out who those constituents are that you might be working with in the future. I wish I had deeper connections with those, so that it might be, you might be using research and research and science to improve conservation, or, you know, understand impacts of fishing industry, or how a public, an individual in the public might be impacted by something. And so I wish there was more opportunities to kind of get out of the academic world while I was in, and see how it's applied to the bigger real world, given finite resources and finite time. So, yeah.
Thank you. Dr. Norton.
I have two answers. One is sort of very technical. I wish I had learned a little bit more about coding. So learning like software programming languages like Python or R. There's so much data right now, you know, that agencies can use that's freely available, and getting your hands around that data can be really difficult. So sometimes I wish I had a little bit more background in that. The other one is, you know, my background was very scientific and very technical. Sort of wish I'd had a little bit of political science. So I'm learning about the political process over the last 2 years in my position. So it's never too late to pick it up, but I kind of wish I'd had that background going into it, understanding how laws get passed and who manages what in communities.
Great, thank you. So this will be the last question before we open it up to questions from the audience. So audience members, please start entering some questions if you have them. The last question that I have for each of you is, what advice would you give to a high school or college student interested in pursuing a career in environmental science? Sam?
I'll echo some of what I heard. Coding, GIS, those kind of hard skills are really good to have and to get your foot in the door as well. And then also kind of what I mentioned earlier, just putting yourself out there. Don't be afraid to ask. Don't be afraid to apply to long shots. Look what kind of fellowships and internships are out there. And yeah, ask for advice. There's lots of good work that needs to be done and a need for people to do it.
Thank you, Ashley. Or I'm sorry, Lane.
Science is awesome. Go for it. Just, I highly recommend anybody interested to pursue a career in marine environmental science. It's very, very interesting. There's always a new challenge and always an opportunity for more people to enter the field. So, and I actually would like to echo what Sam said, that, you know, there's so many fellowships and opportunities out there, really looking for them. There's resources available to you to be successful.
And Dr. Norton.
I would go back again to get your experience in really hard skills. So GIS was a huge foot in the door for me. So it's geographic information systems. That's a very broad range of kind of applications for mapping, essentially. And so that was really huge. If you have the chance to take like a intense GIS course where you get to apply those skills. That's really helpful. And the other thing is never be afraid to ask to get involved. I think when I was an undergrad, especially, I would just cold email folks on campus who I knew were doing research I was interested in. And I think that made a huge difference for me. Just kept bugging until they let me, you know, participate in their mapping projects or participate in shellfish restoration projects. So never be afraid to ask. People can always use help from high school students or undergrad students.
Great, thank you. So here we have a couple questions coming in from the audience. The first one is, what advice could you give a soon-to-be retired teacher about where they can get involved in environmental issues, maybe youth programs or helping to carry out studies, maybe not having to do with science, but definitely focused on coastal and marine issues? Lane, I'll turn this to you first.
Oh no. I don't have a ton of answers for you or a very good answer. I know if you're local to the Lewis campus, there's a whole slew of volunteers that do really good outreach. So maybe that would be a good opportunity to talk about ongoing research and educate the wider community members. That's the only thing that's coming immediately to mind, sorry.
Dr. Norton, perhaps you could chime in.
Yeah, I could give a few opportunities. DenRec has a number of volunteer opportunities. So we have dune grass planting in the spring. Delaware National Estuarine Research Reserve has a lot of volunteer opportunities, and that's up in the Dover area, but they have horseshoe crab surveys in the spring and different programs up there that I think you can get involved in. And I'm going to shamelessly promote our own project, which is that we're getting ready to install a citizen science project at the coast called CoastSnap, where we're going to ask folks like you to go out and take pictures of the beaches after storms, or just daily pictures so we can see how things are changing. So stuff like that, I think, are some good opportunities for you.
Thank you. Another question from the audience, and we'll start with Sam. What other career paths did you consider along your journey, and why did you end up going in the direction that you did?
So I am, again, still early in my career. I've largely cast a broad net and been a generalist and kept my options open for the most part. But I've always been driven towards working in the environment in some aspect, especially with the ocean. And so if I wasn't looking at this from an economist point of view, I could just as easily be happy doing field work for ecology, or even in law, I think would be lots of interesting work out there.
Great. Lane, how about you? Have you considered any other careers along the way, and how did you end up where you are?
I'm also fairly new. I contemplated staying in research and going somewhere for my PhD, but I really, there is understanding that there is probably a finite amount of time and finite amount of resources to do science. I really wanted to understand what you're going to do with that science. So I wanted to see at the policy side of things. And so that's really kind of how I ended up here in Washington, D.C., and really thinking about the implications for what we're going to do with science, that then our broader understanding.
And Dr. Norton?
Similar to Lane, when I started my PhD, I thought I wanted to be a research scientist. I thought I wanted to have a lab at a university. And I think there's a really important niche that role fills. But for me, I wanted to be more applied. I wanted to, you know, be right at that intersection between where science and policy happen and regulation of the environment. So I think that was sort of the hard right in my in my career path.
Great. And then the last question from the audience. For each of you, what obstacles or challenges have you encountered to this point in your career, and how have you overcome them? Sam?
So I don't know if I'm really in my career yet as a current PhD student and doing this fellowship. And what I'm looking at the horizon is going to be applying to jobs. And so that's going to be, you know, big daunting challenge on my own front. But I guess looking back in the past, I think just having your priorities set, having time management, moving forward, all those can be difficult at times to varying degrees. And so having focus to get the job done has sometimes been a challenge. I'll leave it there, I guess. Thanks.
Great, thank you. Lane?
I'd say there's a new challenge every day. They don't just stop as soon as you like find a job. You just sometimes have to put your head down and get through it, focus on working as hard as you can to overcome whatever challenge or obstacle might be in front of you. And I think to a certain extent, at least in my cross discipline area, everybody's kind of learning. So you're all kind of just doing the best that you can and just keep going and don't give up, because you might not be feel like an expert, but there also might only be limited experts in the discipline. So just keep at it.
And Dr. Norton, we'll close with you.
So I think one challenge I had was, especially during my PhD, I had what you call imposter syndrome. I felt like, you know, I didn't know enough to make important decisions or to carry out a project or to lead a team. And I think what I learned through my career was that everyone's kind of learning as we're going along. And that, you know, sometimes, you know, you can learn what you don't know, and two, you probably know more than you think. And so, you know, overcoming that imposter feeling of, you know, not knowing enough and realizing like I have something really valuable to bring to the table. I think that was a big challenge for me.
Great. Well, thank you so much, Sam, Lane, and Ashley. This has been really helpful. I appreciate the guidance and advice that you've shared with our audience here. A quick note to the audience, you will see a poll appear shortly with a few brief questions to help us gauge your response to this session. Please take the time to complete it. We're interested in your feedback. The next session in this track, which is the exploration track, is Paddle Coastal Delaware, which will begin momentarily. The next session in the other track, the investigation track, is titled What You Can Do About Microfibers. Just a reminder, in addition to these live sessions, there is an abundance of pre-recorded material and interactive activities on our Coast Day website. Thank you again for participating, and have a good afternoon.